face out. Y'all been sleeping on me. Better wake up. Put your fly get on. Do your makeup. Drop it real low. And pick it back up. Excellent. Bustin' with the best of them. Super impressive. No worry and stressing them. I'm on my spaceship. Just sit back and watch me.
Hey, welcome to the Swapmoto Live Show presented by Ogio and FMF Racing. Today I am joined by Monster Energy Star Racing Yamaha's Colt Nichols. So, hey, buddy, thank you for coming on. It's been a long time coming, right?
Of course.
We tried last time.
Tried to do it before, got shut down, but no, it's a pleasure. Thanks for having me.
Nice. So, what was on your agenda today? Did you have to do motos out at Paula or anything?
No, not again today. We did that Monday, Tuesday. Just cycle with all the boys. We had Little LeBlanc, Jarrett Fry, Oldenburg, Swanee, Justin Cooper, all of us.
All the teammates.
Did our little program.
No Malcolm today?
No Malcolm today. He went home for Easter. He got out of it.
Hey, what is that like? So Colt trains with Gareth Swanepoel, who's been a guest on the Swapmoto Live Show before. And so it's all you star boys and then Malcolm.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
So what was it like when Mookie came into the fold?
Honestly, it's been great. He's been a fun little addition to all
of us.
Yeah,
a lot of energy, right?
Yeah, a lot of energy, a lot of personality, but it's great. I mean, every now and then it gets a little too businessy, you know, like you do your thing, leave, and he kind of brings a fun kind of element to everybody. Uh-huh. So I actually really enjoy having his presence, and honestly, the amount of progress that he's made, especially honestly since he's gotten hurt, it's been pretty astonishing.
Yeah.
So I think next year he's going to be pretty dangerous. Like if he keeps on the path that he's going, he's going to be really good.
Yeah. He probably makes the mountain bike rides pretty fun, right?
Definitely. he's comedy, pure any cycle, he's pure comedy. For
yeah.
Sure.
Yeah, definitely. So, man, it's been a great year for you. You had your breakthrough victory. I mean, I think there's a lot of us that thought it would have come a couple of years ago. Mm. But how good did it actually feel?
Yeah, that was indescribable, really. To do that in that fashion, really, and everything just worked, you know. It seemed really easy all day, and got a great start, put myself in a good position, and finally made it happen. And it was an incredible feeling, but at the same time it was so much relief, because I'm like, man, I've been wanting to do that for so long, you know. I remember feeling such a crazy way in Oakland in 2016 when I got my first podium on Cycle Trader, and it was kind of the same thing, you know, accomplishing something you've always wanted to do. And at the time, the Cycle Trader thing was maybe unexpected. So it happened. It was just a crazy feeling. And then the win at Anaheim was pure relief to finally do that. Come into a season healthy and be like, this is what I can do, you know? 2 years prior were just a complete struggle in every way possible. And so to come in and do what we've done so far, the season's been great. Might have shocked some people, but for me, I feel like we're right on schedule, and now maybe a little behind where I feel like I should be. But
who would it have shocked?
Yeah, it's all good.
Come on, we're all expecting it.
Yeah, it's I would have hoped so. I feel like I've shown that I've got talent and speed on a dirt bike, and good fitness and all that, but man, it's tough, you know. It's hard to win races, and you know, my buddy Justin Bogle's he's won 3 races, you know, in his lights career, and you know, he's even told me too, he's like, you gotta cherish that and try to do everything you can. Those are really, really hard to come by, you know. Yeah. So to win that first one was huge, and you know, I hope I can end it the way we started at Vegas. That'd be nice.
Yeah. Was it even better because it was Anaheim?
Yeah, I think so. Yeah. I mean, all of the pressure and all the everything, and I always loved racing in Anaheim. I love that kind of stuff. So that definitely made it a little sweeter, the fact that it was Anaheim one, you know. It was awesome, but in the same time, it kind of sucked, because going into Phoenix, it's like, I really need to go, you know, like if I wasn't ready before, I gotta be now. So I felt like I handled it pretty well for the most part, but some of those races, I wish I could go back, of course, but it's all right, live and learn.
Yeah. What was it like running the red plate?
Yeah, that was really cool too. It looked
obviously incredible. Were you matching your gloves?
Yeah, gloves, goggles, everything. And I wore the red boots, I think, the first 5 races. So that was really cool. That's a position I've never been in before, even been close to be honest with you. So that was really, really cool. But like I said, I wish I could have done maybe a few things a little different. Mm-hmm. And in hindsight, looking back now, I think some of the races were a little more reserved than they should have been. And that's just learning, though, being in that position and being like, okay, we don't need to do that again, you know? So living and learning. But, man, that was a really, really cool thing. And I'm hoping during the summer we can do that again.
Yeah. I think last year the big buzz was around you, but then you broke your arm, right?
Mm-hmm.
The humerus?
Yep.
Yeah, that was... That was a big setback last year.
Yeah, that one was horrible to do that before the season. But honestly, it kind of, I think, humbled me a little bit in a way. Before that, I was feeling, you know, pretty high and mighty on myself. I had been doing everything so good. Mm-hmm. And you get brought back to reality pretty quick, you know, when something like that happens. So it sucked, obviously. I hated that happened. But at the same time, it could have been the best thing for me, you know, mm-hmm. to have to go through that. And then when I broke my arm again... 3 rounds in was that one was actually really tough for whatever reason. I don't know why. That was just a very emotional kind of injury for me, mm-hmm. and really struggled to cope with all that. But yeah, once we got back from that, it was all good. You know, you get back into riding and racing and everything's fine. But at the time, it was pretty devastating. But live and learn. And I think it's a good thing it happened for me that way.
Yeah. So how are you feeling going into this summer's 250 Nationals? What sort of expectations do you have?
Yeah, the expectations are pretty high, I think, for myself, really. It's kind of tough, too, because I've never really done that great in outdoors. You know, mm-hmm. I've had a handful of motos or whatever, but we've learned a lot the past 2 years, and coming in unhealthy, you know, mm-hmm. has been unfortunate, too. But as of right now, I've already done more motos in preparation than I've done in all 3 seasons combined, really? You know, going into outdoors. So we're way ahead of anywhere we've ever been. The bike is stupid fast, especially mm-hmm. for outdoors. So I'm looking forward to it, man. It's going to be really, really good. I feel like it'll kind of be similar to the way Supercross has been with, you know, a lot of star guys battling for podiums and wins. And, you know, same thing with some PC guys and all that kind of stuff. But it's going to be a fun summer. It's going to be hot and brutal, I'm sure. But I feel like I'll finally be prepared for it. So that's a nice feeling.
Yeah. Hey, what's the team dynamic like at Star Yamaha? Like you got Dylan. Mm. And then Mitchell and who else? Justin.
Yeah, Justin just has 4. So
you guys get along pretty well. I mean, I was cracking up when I did the How Was Your Weekend with you guys at Denver.
Yeah, yeah.
And you and Dylan were just like chilling on the couch.
Yeah, yeah. We were watching the race on my phone or whatever. But it's getting, honestly, the more I'm around Dylan and kind of interact with them, and just we've spent the last 3 seasons racing the same coast, so I've got to know him a little bit better each time. And mm-hmm. I really like the guy. You know, it's hard because he's obviously from a different country, doesn't mm-hmm. even speak the same language, all this stuff. But the more I get to know him, the more I'm realizing, you know, like he actually is a really good dude. It's just it's different for him, you know, to be mm-hmm. over here. And I train with Mitchell and Justin every day, so I see them a lot. But I really like everybody on the team. I feel like we have a really good dynamic. It's super smooth and easy, mm-hmm. which sometimes can be tough, especially with me and Dylan, like battling for the championship and all that. But I feel like we've handled it well, and now I'm in a position where I can maybe help him out in the championship, which I was hoping.
Did it ever get weird?
Not really, no. Because just like anything else, I wanted to be the first on the team, and so did he, you know? Yeah. So it actually was really good for us, because I'm sure he hates getting beat by me, and I hate getting beat by him.
Yeah.
So I actually think that helped both of us a little bit, to be honest with you. And before the season, I feel like me and him were the strongest 2 on the team, and usually, you know, those 2 get split mm-hmm. For whatever mm-hmm. team. And Bobby really wanted us to both race West, so we did that, and we're hoping that we could get a title out of that. But mm-hmm. there's still another race to go, and I'm hoping I can help out in some sort of way, but we'll see.
Yeah. What's it like with, you know, the 3 of you guys are all with Swanee,
mm-hmm.
and then he's with DV, right?
Yeah.
Is it kind of like 2 teams within a team, or is it not like that?
In a way, yeah. I mean, because he can really do whatever he wants. You know, he can alienate himself, and the team has no say in mm-hmm. what he does.
But the deal with Swanee isn't a team deal. It's all you guys individually?
It's individually, but at the same time, it is a team deal. Mm-hmm. You know, the team tries to put a retainer on Swanee. They want mm-hmm. him to work with Star Racing athletes only, and that's kind of how it all came about. But yet we, you know, pay Swanee individually for, you know, his knowledge and everything that he provides. Mm-hmm. So it's a really good deal, and it works out great. But at the same time, it's hard sometimes too, because the team is very, very involved with everything that we do, you know, and at times it's like Dylan can kind of just do whatever. He has a lot of freedom, you know, so, and that's a good and bad thing. But it's been working out really well. And I think everyone's comfortable and happy in their positions. At times, of course, there's tension. You know, I feel like people are saying this and that, and you got a lot going on. But for the most part, everyone knows their role, and you know, we're able to go out and do what we need to do.
Yeah. Do you like the training aspect of your job? Like, do you enjoy the gym days, the bicycle rides?
I do. Yeah, I actually really do. I feel like even post-racing, you know, when I retire and stuff, I'll still go out and run, cycle, do all these things. I've always been a very active person. I really like that side of things. And every now and then I love being in the gym and being a meathead and doing all that stuff. You know, it's kind of fun to me, and I enjoy that side of the process. Of course, at times you don't want to, you're sore or whatever, but I actually do. I really enjoy it for sure.
Nice. Well, hey, we're going to take a quick break to hear from our sponsors. But when we come back, we're going to have more with Colt Nichols. Hey, welcome back to the Swapmoto Live Show, presented by Ogio and FMF Racing, with Colt Nichols, who is you're a multi-time Costa Rican motocross champ.
One time. Latin American champ and Costa Rican champ, all in the same year.
Dude, fill us in on that. I mean, that was you kind of made your pro debut.
Yeah.
In another country, right?
In a sense, yeah. I did the arena cross thing right before that. Can't say that went great, to be honest, but. Did that whole season, learned a lot, and then that summer I was like, well, I don't really know what to do. And Bowers and my buddy Casey Huntley were like, hey, man, we have another spot in Costa Rica if you want to go. And they had no idea how I would do, and I didn't really either. But I got an opportunity to go down there from Marisol Rios. She was the one that orchestrated all that, and man, that was probably the most fun summer of my life. It was so cool. Got to go race dirt bikes, do it in a different country that I had never been to before, in a beautiful, beautiful place.
Costa Rica is amazing.
Oh, unreal, man. Yeah. We got to visit some really, really cool places, practice Saturday, race Sunday, then fly home Monday, but it was like a little mini vacation. And it was fun. I had a lot of really good memories. A lot of good dudes too, like Bowers, Ames, Nick Way, Travis Baker went to a race. Jake Canada was at a race. Moheb was our mechanic at one point. Then Donk was our mechanic. And it was a lot of fun. Really, really, like I said, good group of dudes, and it was a really cool experience.
Yeah. It's always cool seeing motocross in other countries that aren't like motocross powerhouse countries, you know?
Yeah.
Like Costa Rica, I've been to Costa Rica twice on vacation and I didn't get to ride moto, but I went on the Costa Rica Unlimited tour.
Yeah.
And so I got to ride bikes there and stuff, but Jesse Huntley went down and did the Costa Rica thing, so I followed him closely because he was my buddy.
Yeah.
But like, even when I went to Tahiti to go watch Maddo ride the wave.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
In Chopu.
Yeah.
That weekend was the kickoff of the Tahitian National Championships, right?
Wow. Okay.
So we went and watched, and it was a crack up. But I mean, motocross is universal. You know, everyone does it because they love it, right?
Exactly. Exactly.
But it's always interesting to see it in a different country.
Oh yeah, it was for me too. Like the first time going down there, I had no idea what to expect. Yeah. I didn't know what the track's gonna be like, fans, what anything, you know? And I feel like to me, we were at like a little local race, you know, whenever I was back at home, being younger, coming up in the amateur ranks, and it was just so fun. There was no pressure. I got to go out there and just enjoy what I was doing. And I mean, the first time I showed up, I was riding some random bike that some guy had loaned us. And, I mean, the bolts were all rusty and you know, all kinds of stuff, but it was, that made the experience, you know, and it was just really, really cool. I mean, not a whole lot of people can say they got to go race in a different country. I think I went down there 10 or 11 times. Mm-hmm. And then I got to travel with Peru and do the same thing over there for the Latin American Championship. And that was just a really cool thing for me. It gave me confidence again, because I had won something, you know. I won a championship, and I got to win races, and it was against, you know, some guys that had just spanked me all season in arena cross, you know. Bowers and Ames, all these guys. So it was a confidence thing for me, and then on top of that, it kind of revived my career in a way. It gave me you know, a reason to race and an opportunity to make a little bit of money, and it was just cool, man. The fans just ate it up, and I kind of looked a little Costa Rican, I guess, since I'm a little darker. So they loved it. They would come up and just start speaking Spanish to me. And I'm like, I don't know, you know, I don't know what you're saying, but this is cool, you know. They seemed to love me down there. And it was just a really, really cool experience.
Yeah. Were the tracks like really hard packed?
Stupid hard pack.
Yeah, and slippery, right?
Yeah. They don't really have much equipment to do anything. So if they would go out there and work it with a tractor or something like that, but it rains almost every day down there. So it rained, wash everything away, and then it's just concrete underneath.
Yeah.
So it was just really, really slick. And Nick Way, I don't think, really enjoyed that side of things that much, but it was, man, it was cool. Some of the tracks were just beautiful to look at. It had all these hills and volcano in the background. Mm-hmm. And I mean, it was cool.
And the monkeys and
monkeys, all kinds of stuff. Yeah, it was fun.
Definitely.
Very, very fun.
Did you see any sloths while you were down there?
I didn't, no. We went to a few little spots down by the beach, and we had a race where we stayed at this motel that was fairly sketchy, but there was like an all natural hot springs down there. Uh-huh. So you would walk down a little ways, and it was just like all this beautiful water and all this rock and a little bar down there and all kinds of stuff. So got to see a bunch of really amazing things, spend it with some really good people. So that just made the whole trip.
Nice. Right on. Are they still doing that? Are people still racing?
A little bit. I think this year, I don't think they're taking any U.S. guys down there. I had a lot of buddies that went and done it. Even my buddy Chase Marquier, who's a privateer on the East Coast, he went down there and raced. And I know a handful of other people that went after I went. But I think she's just helping some Costa Rican guys right now, not bringing down any U.S. guys. But she was an awesome lady. And the guy that really helped us was Federico. He was the guy that kind of orchestrated everything. He's been around for a while, and he was a really, really good dude, too. So those are good people. They just love dirt bikes. And,
yeah.
You know, that made it cool for us. We got to go down there and experience something that not a whole lot of people get to. So
definitely, definitely. All right, so on Instagram, right?
Yep.
One of my favorite things on a Saturday morning is to see the weekly, like, walking into the stadium fashion shoot, right?
Oh, yeah.
So tell me about that. You and Bogle and...
Yeah, my buddy, it's me, Justin, and Brad Friesen.
Yeah.
It was the night before Anaheim won, and I just bought a pair of new shoes, of course. That's like a weekly thing, I guess, for me. But I was telling Justin, I'm like, dude, we got to do something like this. I have so much stuff in my closet that I never wear, you know, that I buy. I think it's cool. And I don't have any place to wear it. And I'm like, why don't we just start wearing it like into the race? And then we'll just change when we get to the truck or whatever, like the NBA players do, you know? Yeah, literally come in, change the team shirt and change pants and shoes and go off track walking. He's like, yeah, that'd be a good idea. Let's try it, you know? And we did it the first two rounds, and we both thought it was awesome. You know, we loved it. We never shy away from the camera anyway. So that was perfect for us. And it's just us being us, you know? This is probably not normal for a lot of people, especially in this industry.
And, yeah.
But that's okay though. I don't mind that, you know, we're maybe a little out of the ordinary, but, we love this stuff. You know, we're very influenced by basketball, fashion, music, all kinds of stuff. And, it's just us being us, which I think is great. And I hope that we influence some kids down the road, maybe not now, but some kids down the road to be themselves and enjoy this.
You influence my guy, Anton.
There it is.
You know?
I'll take one at a time.
He asked me to take a picture of him walking into the lunch today.
See? It's going to catch on slowly but surely. Yeah. I think that's great, though, man. I think it's really, really cool. I really hope kids can see that and be themselves. And
yeah, have a little bit of fun.
Yeah, have a little bit of character, a little bit of anything, you know, not just look like every other guy coming in. So I think that's the whole idea. Have some fun. And if you're interested in something, don't shy away from it and be yourself.
Yeah. So were you pumped on those boots there?
I was. Yeah, that was cool. That was really, really cool. Everyone else was like, what the hell is it? Even the gear. And I'm like, man, that's awesome.
Yeah.
Like, I think that's great. But nobody else knows what that is, you know?
Yeah.
It's a very small group of people that would know what that is or the brand itself or anything. So I think that's awesome. Getting moto in other places that, you know, is probably not that common. Is it's good. It's good for all of us, whether they like it or not. So it's good for sure.
Obviously, you and Justin Bogle are really tight.
Yep.
Was it since you guys were a little thing?
Yes.
Was he must have always been a class or two above you, right?
Yeah. But yeah, we always had that year or two where we raced each other, and then we would split, you know, for a year or so, then come back together and race 60s, 80s, all the way through big bikes. But it literally started when I might have been 5 or 6. We used to go to 59th and Douglas, this place in Oklahoma City that was notorious. And one of the terra firmas.
Is that a track?
Yeah, and one of the terra firmas.
Sounds like a hamburger steak.
Yeah, Robbie Raynard is riding there, and they had this ginormous tunnel jump. Uh-huh. Might have been terra firma 2 or 3, or actually, it might have been the first one. He was number 33 on a Cowie, whatever year that was. But it was a very iconic track, and me and Justin, the first time we raced there, like I said, we were 5 or 6 on peewees, and we just duked it out. And our parents obviously met, and then we went to the next race and did the same thing, and so it just kind of took off from there, and we've seen each other every weekend until now, you know, so... it was just really fun. It never went the opposite direction for some reason. Like I knew it has with some, you know, people, they get too competitive and they don't speak anymore. But with us, it was always way, way more than that. We were really, really good friends and really raced each other hard, but good. And it's been really, really fun because I've known that dude literally my whole life. You know, that's very, very rare in what we do, especially to be, you know, successful at it too. So he's won a championship and now riding for a really, really good team, and his results are getting better and better, and he's starting to figure it out.
Yeah,
a little
dude,
bit
how
more,
good
so.
Was Denver?
That was unreal.
Yeah,
unreal. I was so happy for him. He's been going through a lot of stuff that, you know, a lot of people don't know about, and for him to go do what he did was honestly incredible. I was so pumped for him, and he held so strong, and it was just a really, really good race. It was such a good thing, you know, to see my friend go do that and something he's been working so hard to do. So I was very pumped for him.
Yeah.
For
sure. I always get pumped when I see guys that are friends and like, a 250 guy and a 450 guy and come together before the start of the next race to share information. You know, I saw Bogle come running up to the podium.
Yeah.
And you guys were talking a little bit. So what was the advice there?
None that was taken by him. I woke up, he's like, hey, how is it? And I'm like, yeah, man, it's good. Go down the far left side of the whoops. There's like a little bit of traction and you can enter it a little faster. And he's like, oh yeah, for sure. I watched the whole main event. He went down the right side of the whoops every single lap, got passed twice on the left side. I'm like, dude. But I mean, that's all right. But yeah, that was the only advice I gave him. The track was fairly, simple, and it was just so hard pack and wasn't a whole lot really you could do. That was the one thing I found that was maybe a little better, but he just didn't feel like taking my advice. But that's all right. Laugh about it now.
Yeah, nice. Hey, man, we're going to take another quick break to hear from our sponsors. We'll be right back. Welcome back to the Swapmoto Live Show, presented by Ogio and FMF Racing. Once again, we're here with Colt Nichols. You talked about buying some cool shoes before Anaheim 1. So I take it you don't have like a shoe sponsor. Like that was so prevalent back in the day. You know, everyone had something, but so that kind of frees you up, right?
Yeah,
so
yeah, it does.
What are the... what's the criteria on the shoes that you're going to invest your hard-earned money on?
That's tough. No criteria, really. Just if I have a really bad problem, like I don't really think things through that well when it comes to that stuff. Like
Impulse.
If I see it and I like it, complete impulse buyer. I'm like, yeah, I'm doing it. And then I later look at my credit card statement. I'm like, damn it, that was probably stupid. But
yeah,
I just, if I like it, I have a real problem with saying no. I'm just like, screw it, I'll buy it. And then later I'm like, wow, that's pretty stupid, but what are you gonna do? I already bought it. So that's just, I mean, it's just me though. I have that's stuff that I like. I mean, different strokes for different folks, you know? So I love going and playing golf on my time off and buying things I think looks cool, dressing up to go eat dinner, you know, whatever. I enjoy that kind of stuff. So not a whole lot of people really care about that, to be honest. They're like, whatever, clothes is clothes, but just something I like, something I'm into.
Yeah. All right. So tell me about these kicks.
These kicks were a...
Like, see, to a square old man like me, I see the star and I go, oh, those are Converse, but they're obviously not, right?
Yeah. So these are a purchase that I did after... one of the races, I told myself, I said, if I get on the podium again, I'm gonna buy these shoes. Cause they'd been in my cart for like months. Uh-huh. And I was like, I'm gonna pull the trigger finally. And I bought these and they're pretty damn expensive. So it was probably stupid, but.
How much were those?
I think these were like, probably like $450 or so.
Oh.
This is Golden Goose. Yeah, Golden Goose Deluxe brand. And it's like a really expensive brand. And probably stupid, like I said, but. You know, sometimes you can do what you gotta do. I'm doing this for y'all.
So, you know, my boss at Cycle News one time told me, hey man, you earn money to spend it.
Exactly.
Right?
I can't take it with me when I'm gone. I might as well look cool while I'm here, you know, and I think this makes me look cool, so why not?
So aside from the shoes and the fashion impulse things that you like, are you investing in other things? Like okay, in the past, in the motocross, I'm not gonna name any names, but there've been certain guys that have come up and boom, had success in the 125 class, dating myself, but you know, and went out and bought cars and a bunch of stuff, and then you know, hang out with them these days and they don't really have much show for anything they did, right?
Yeah. I know actually quite a few people that are like that, and that's unfortunate, you know, that happened that way for those guys, but aside from doing all this and buying probably some dumb shit I shouldn't buy, I'm trying to be a little smarter about it, you know? So I have a buddy back home, a kid that actually used to race for a Cycle Trader. We grew up together and we were really, really good friends. His name's Gregory Gear. And, his dad is just a super, super good guy. He was like a second dad to me. Really helps me out with a lot of stuff, business side of things. So he's kind of helped me get started in the rental house stuff. So bought a few rental houses to try to be my retirement, if you will.
Yeah, because
I mean, I know the stuff doesn't last forever, even though I want it to. But trying to do that side of things to have something to fall back on, because like you said, it doesn't last forever. Then whenever it gets done, I don't want to be like, well, what am I going to do now? You know, I want to have it all done and kind of planned out. And the age that I am, the things that I do, I, you know, make more money than I need right now. So I want to be smart with it and try to be like, okay, well, this is for later on, you know, whenever I'm not getting these checks every month that are so nice to have right now. So, rental house game will probably be my calling whenever I'm done with their bikes. And I don't want to have to necessarily do anything, you know? So while I have the money, I want to invest in something that can make me money. And then after that, be able to sit back and, you know, drink beer and play golf on the weekends. That'd be the idea once I retire. So definitely.
Hey, and you and I are very fortunate in that we're both on the team. Toyota Vescondito.
Oh, right?
Yeah, so you don't have to spend money on a truck,
I know, they've been hooking me up, man.
They got you.
Yeah, they've been hooking me up. Yeah, they're awesome dudes down there. Damien, all the dudes at Toyota Vescondito have been a real blessing to me. That was a big purchase that I had, you know, before I signed with Star. And for them to kind of take that away and give me a lot of stability, and I get to drive around, obviously, a really sick-looking truck. It's pretty sick. So those dudes are awesome. They help out a lot of dudes in the moto industry, and I can't say enough good things about those people for sure.
They keep giving you the color I want.
I know, dude. You got the
you
baby
first
blue.
Had the cement one, and you got the blue one now. I've had two silver ones in a row, you know.
But oh, goodness gracious.
Thanks, man.
I know. I keep stealing all the flavor. That's all right.
Yeah.
Got to.
Hey, talk about the collab you had with FMF recently, like that casual wear.
Yeah, that was a really cool thing that we put together. One of the designers actually at FMF, Alex, he really helped me with everything. He actually was the one that helped me create this logo for myself and kind of move forward with trying to brand myself a little bit. And I came to them and I was like, hey, man, I just really want to make some some gear that people can have that's mine. You know, I don't want it to just be like Colt Nichols 39, you know, like everybody else kind of does. I want it to be something a little different, and I didn't want it to include my number since it's not a permanent number and all this stuff. So they were really, that dude has been awesome. He's helped me out a lot. Just creatively trying to open up some doors I didn't know that we could do, and venture off into those kind of things, because obviously I'm into the fashion and kind of doing that kind of stuff anyway. So it's been really fun for me to learn about all of it, then the distribution side, what sells, what doesn't, and all kinds of stuff. But him and Donnie have been really huge in trying to help me, and we did that little design together, and I got to approve all of it and help and do all this stuff, and that was really fun for me. So I feel like it went well. I feel like we sold a lot of shirts and stuff like that, and that was the whole idea. It wasn't trying to make money. I just wanted, you know, if somebody wanted something of me, then they could have it. You know, that was, that's mine. And I, something that I endorse and wear and I think is cool as well. So I was hoping other people did, but I think it went well.
Was, okay, so there is the FMF line, right? But then I saw on your Instagram, you were selling some others like windbreakers and stuff. Was that FMF is also?
No, that was completely separate deal. Like the stuff that I have is like CN merch that was through FMF. And then what I was selling, or I personally wasn't, but all the other stuff was like the Pack EMH stuff, which is me, Justin, and Brad Frace, and just something that we've kind of been doing for a really long time. Even back when we were, you know, 17, 18 years old, just making stuff we thought was cool. And then we'd made enough of them to where we were like, okay, well, let's sell a few of them, see if other people like it too. You know, maybe it'll take off someday. And that's not even the idea. It's just stuff that we think is cool. And if we like it and we have a few extra, we're going to sell some. And hopefully everybody else does too, but that's been a really fun side of things too, trying to see how that all is kind of working together. And it's just us, you know, it's just us having fun, what we do. And Brad's really, really good with the camera work and doing some things like that. And then also he's got a real mind for that kind of stuff. So to see him kind of go to work, and then obviously him and Justin make a lot of music together and stuff. So it's just been fun, man. We're just a really good, tight-knit group of friends and just doing what we think is cool. And if it's not to anybody else, we don't really care. It's just us, you know? So it's been fun though.
Yeah, Frace, man, I've gotten to spend a little time with him at the races lately. He's such a great guy.
He is, man. And you would never understand, like, his story. I mean, nobody really does, you know? But the guy is, honestly, he's an inspiration to me, and, I mean, even to Justin and everybody that's, like, really close with Brad. He's just he's a really good dude, and he's got a great heart on him, and he's been through a lot, but you never know that, ever. You know, just looking at the guy, talking to him, he never mentions it, he never does anything. And the dude doesn't, I mean, I feel like he doesn't give himself enough credit for everything that he's done. And to bounce back from the injuries and things that he's had has been pretty astonishing. So he's a good dude. And like I said, you would never know it, but I mean, he's the man. I love that guy.
So he and Justin, the whole Pack EMH thing, what is your role in Pack EMH?
I don't do no
rapping. Are there some background vocals that we don't know about?
There's not any. They've been trying to get me to do it for a while, and I've never, I guess, had the courage to go do it. One of these days, probably, I'm sure. But I don't really know if you want to say I have a real role. I told them if they ever went on tour, I'm going to be like a hype man and just like get on the stage and just hype everybody up, you know? But no, it's just all of us just kind of doing everything together. Like Brad will come to me with an idea, and then I'll be like, yeah, I mean, that's great, but maybe let's try to do this, this, or that. And it's just all of us creating something that we're involved with, you know, and that we have influence that we think is cool. So whether it be clothes, whether it be songs, you know, the way he wants to put this out or the way he wants to brand this or whatever, it's just all of us kind of figuring it out on our own. And that's been the fun part, you know, is we don't have anyone to tell us what to do. We're just doing stuff that we think is cool. So it's been quite a little process, but I mean, it's really, really fun for all of us to do it together. Sure.
That's what's cool is you see the three of you guys and you're having fun together at the races. It's like some guys get way too serious and it's just business.
And it kind of sucks when it's like that, you know? I mean, I've been there, done that, where I'm like trying to just be like this, and man, it's so hard, you know? Because I don't want to be the guy that looks back and is like, man, I wish I could have done this, this, or that. Like, I'm putting my heart and soul into this and I'm doing everything that I can, daily, weekly, everything. But then, you know, when I show up to the race, I want to have fun. You know, even during the week, I want to have fun and I want to enjoy things that I like, listen to the music I like, wear the brands that I like, do the things that I want to do. And we all have that same attitude. And especially Justin, he's been through a lot the past few years and been on the side where he's not making any money and he's doing this because he loves it, you know, he's just trying to get back to where he was at one point. And I think that was an eye opener for him too. He's like, man, I want to enjoy this a little more. I'm tired of just hating my life all the time over dirt bikes. You know, I want to enjoy this stuff. So that's what we've been trying to do. We're having a good time. And I really hope that, you know, some younger kids can see that and kind of take some of the steps that we've taken. And it always is better, obviously, when you're doing good, like I have been this year. So, yeah. But yeah, we're enjoying it. We have a really, really good time, but we do it together too, you know, so that makes it even cooler.
Cool. That's awesome. Yeah. Well, hey, sadly, we are out of time, but hey, buddy, thanks for coming
on. Of course. Thank you for having me.
Glad it finally happened.
I appreciate it. Yeah.
So, yeah. So if you like what you saw, please subscribe to our YouTube channel. Follow at Swapmoto Live on Instagram. And yours is
Colt Nichols 39.
And you have to change it every year then, right?
Every single year. It's a ball up.
Is there a Colt Nichols?
There is. And I'm going to DM that kid one of these days if you're watching
this. Give it up. Give it up. So, right on. Hey, thank you for watching.
Yep.